My name is Brian Metz. I'm one of the pastors here at Worthy Redeemer. If we haven't met, I would love to shake hands and say hello to you today. Every week, we want to recite and have our mission on the forefront of our minds and hearts and on our tongues. And so our mission is to make disciples who make disciples for the good of the city and to the glory of Christ. And so we're going to repeat that back. And I want to do it a little different this morning. I'm going to ask you to stand with me because we're going to be standing for worship anyway. So do y'all stand with me? I'm going to say four, and you're going to say the good of the city. And when I say two, you'll say the glory of Christ. So our mission is to make disciples who make disciples. Four and two. Amen. Let's worship together.
Amen, church. As we continue in our singing, we're going to stop for a second and just read some scripture together to encourage one another. And this morning, our call to worship, it comes from Isaiah chapter 25, verses 6 through 9. I'm going to read the beginning part, if you'll join in with me on verse 9. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow and of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on this day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Let's continue in singing.
Loves.
church. You may be seated.
I wanted to begin this morning with some words of David's from Psalm 138. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. On the day I called you, you answered me. My strength of soul you increased. All the kings of earth shall give you thanks, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth, and they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. Let's pray. Father, I think I speak for the majority of us here that we desire to give you thanks with whole hearts, to bow down before you and to give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. But sometimes, as it says farther down in this psalm, we're walking in the midst of trouble. We all have troubles. We all have trials. We all have challenges. We all have things that perhaps cause us to doubt your goodness. We all have issues in our lives, whether they be in relationships, whether they be in the workplace, whether they be in families, extended families, with children. We have challenges, things that might cause us to doubt, might cause us to grumble, might cause us to turn away rather than to turn to you and to bow down before you. Father, may we be encouraged by the truth of your word that says, the Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. That's the truth. You accomplish good things for your people. You not only work for our good, you work for your own glory. And what you do for us is something that brings glory to you. We don't pray just because of what we get from you. We pray because we realize that you are the source of life, that you're the only hope for us. May we learn increasingly to walk by faith, not by sight, and to learn what it means as followers of Christ to abide in him. I was encouraged this week by those words at the end of Matthew 11, where Jesus says, come unto me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Father, you want us to rest from all of the things that we might pursue to try to find satisfaction, to try to find meaning, and to see that the satisfaction, the meaning is in you. So I pray for myself, I pray for my brothers and sisters that we would be learning to do that increasingly, to look to you because you're the only hope. We thank you that we have this access into your very throne room where there is abundant grace and mercy, and we can come boldly to you in this way, and you delight to hear from us. May we individually and corporately do this more and more. Avail ourselves of the resources that you have given to us in Christ, not just as we face difficulty, but on the sunny days of life. May we not forget your abundant grace, your mercies to us. I pray for Pastor Brian as he comes up in a moment to speak. May he enjoy the strength and the guidance of the Spirit and proclaim the truth of the gospel with power, with clarity, and may we be ready to receive what you would want for us to hear. May we not just be expecting someone to tickle our ears, as it said in Scripture will happen in the last days, and certainly happens a lot in this world. May we be ready to hear what the Spirit says to this church in particular today. Father, would you glorify yourself in our midst? We rejoice that you are present with us. You've told us that you'd never leave us nor forsake us. You've said that where two or three are gathered in your name, you would be in the midst. So we thank you for that. So we would ask that you would work by your Spirit to bring glory to our Savior, by whom we have access to you and who has made a way for us to be in union with the Holy Trinity. Thank you for this amazing grace, this incredible gift. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. I was Hold on. Thank you. I know you want to get that music for the man, but he asked me to read something, so I'm going to read that. It's Colossians 1. So if you have a Bible or if you have a device, would you please turn to Colossians 1? And I'm going to be reading verses 15 through 23. Colossians 1, starting at verse 15. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him, if indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, became a minister.
Thank you, Steve, for praying for us and for reading that passage for us. I asked Steve to read that passage. I was initially going to preach from Titus today, Titus chapter 2 specifically, and I'm not going to preach this sermon right now. I'm just saying, I was going to preach about discipleship and what it means to do discipleship in community through older men teaching younger men, older women teaching younger women, and how you have to be present for that to take place. But the Lord shifted me this week and moved me to Colossians. And I asked Steve to read that passage of Colossians, though I'm not preaching on that specific text, because I wanted us to put in the forefront of our minds, if you caught, 15 through 23 is about Jesus Christ, his preeminence, and who he is in light of who we are, and that he is the worthy Redeemer, that he is our Savior, our friend, a friend of sinners, a friend of saints, the one who redeems. And so I wanted to put Jesus before you today in light of what we're going to talk about. The title of my message this morning is Building a Culture of Discipleship with Gratitude and Love. As the discipleship pastor, it is my honor and privilege to talk about discipleship all the time, to get into the nuts and bolts of discipleship, to read books on discipleship, to hopefully spur you on and encourage you to be discipled. I have a question to start us off with this morning for you as a sort of personal question. Don't raise your hand, just answer with your heart, as the old preachers would say, right? Has anyone discipled you? Have you ever been in a relationship in which you have been discipled? Keep that question in mind as we journey together. I'm getting old. I had a birthday recently, and I just got to have these on, so good. Bear with me, all right? Before I jump into the message this morning, I have a few sort of personal remarks that I'd like to make, if that's okay. As your pastor, as one of your pastors, I just want to let you know how grateful I am to be one of your pastors. I'm grateful for you. I know that you're a prayerful people and a loving people. It was evidenced the week that my wife was in the hospital. Many of you have cared for one another and cared for us in many different ways, through meal chains, gifts to newborns, attending weddings, praying for each other, setting up and tearing down every Sunday, praying for each other during the week, running sound or slides or cameras, making Worthy Redeemer an inviting place by your handshakes and smiles and even your high fives. Yeah, I wrote some of that out because I thought I would mess it up. If we look around the world today, it's hard to be a church. Craig spoke about how folks are deconstructing all the time, leaving the church. Statistics are not in our favor as far as young people leaving the faith. Statistics are not in our favor of churches growing and being healthy. A healthy church is one that exposits the scriptures, has evangelism, understands what church membership means, cares for one another. We're trying to build a healthy church here. We're trying to build a healthy church through discipleship, which can be a wonky word for some folks. It's a church word, right? Like, I mean, you put in disciples or discipleship in any document and it wants to correct it to discipline because it's not a common word. Here's the thing. From my heart to you, I want you to know that I don't take for granted you showing up on a Sunday morning. I don't take for granted that when we pull up, the flags are out. I don't take for granted that when we walk in here, we can hear a worship band practicing. I don't take for granted that there's coffee and tables set up. We're grateful for all of you for serving, but in the ways that you also do things and are the church in ways that aren't recorded or can't be seen, the way that you forgive one another. I'm grateful for the way that you love one another and care for one another to just show up. Whether that's showing up to a gospel community with a baked good or just showing up to gospel community at all. Or perhaps you just show up to a coffee meeting and listen to someone else's heart. I'm grateful to be your pastor, one of your pastors. And I'm grateful for this small piece of community called Worthy Redeemer Church. Wade got to cry a few weeks ago in August when we did our anniversary. I wrote everything down so I wouldn't cry. I appreciate you. And I appreciate this. I've been in ministry for quite some time now, over 2 decades. And it's still amazing to me the weight and sort of the not the burden necessarily, but the heaviness that comes with pastoring a church. This is my first 2 years of being an actual elder at a church, which comes with a whole other side of responsibility and a whole heaping helping of more attentiveness to what this responsibility holds. The scriptures teach that elders are to be about two things, the ministry of the word and prayer. And so I'd like for us to turn our attention to one of the things that Paul modeled for us, which was his prayer for the Colossian church. And as we listen to what Paul's writing, I want to kind of superimpose my own personal agenda on that, which is, I hope that you will also read this letter from the Colossians as a letter to you from your pastor this morning. Throughout the letter of Colossians, the Apostle Paul uses themes of gratitude and love. From the jump, from the very beginning here in Colossians, he exclaims his thankfulness and love for the Colossians, for the church at Colossae. Their faith and their faithful service is continuing to encourage him as he's in prison. Now, I want to remind you, Paul is writing from prison. He does have a couple of friends with him. He writes about that in the beginning and writes about that at the end of this book or this letter. But what's important for us to know is that Paul is in prison. And he writes words like, I'm thankful for you. I thank God for you. So let's jump into the road ahead. I've got four or five movements here that I would like for us to look at. The first one is the attitude of gratitude. We'll cover a couple of verses here. Then we'll follow that up with the power of prayer. The great exchange comes next. And then we'll follow that with discipleship as a journey of love and gratitude. And finally ending with disciples assemble. Right? Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. All right. It's corny. Can't you drop my youth minister stuff at all? So here we go. Attitude of gratitude. Paul's attitude of gratitude is clearly seen here in Colossians 1, 3 through 4. If you will, turn with me to Colossians 1. If you're already there, that's awesome. verse 3. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love that you have for all the saints. Well, here's Paul, and he's kind of like tipping his hat. You're actually getting, like, here's the curtain thrown back, right? We always think of the Apostle Paul as this great theologian. We may think of the Apostle Paul as the guy who wrote most of the New Testament. And yet here in this letter, he's giving the church at Colossae, which he had never met, mind you. He's giving him his heart, and he's letting them kind of, open up his heart so that they can see what he's really, really passionate about. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. He's a praying man. He prays for them. He pastorally prays for them as elders should do, as your elders do for you. He prays for them in a few things here. When he does pray, he always thanks God, the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. He sets up a framework of authority there. The Father, he's praying to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And what are the things that he prays for? Well, he prays for their faith in Christ Jesus. He's thanking God for their faith in Christ Jesus. He has heard tales of their faith, of their good works, of the things that would demonstrate their faith. And he says to them, I'm praying and thanking God for your faith in Jesus Christ. You see, in Colossae, at the time, there was this teaching questioning whether Christ alone would be sufficient. And he's reminding them that what they have in Christ is enough. Church, what we have in Christ is enough. Even though there are wars and rumors of wars right now, what we have in Christ is enough. We see great evil saturating this world because Christ is enough. And the world is rejecting Christ. The world rejects Christ. This is why we see this great evil in the world. But not only is he thanking God for their faith in Christ Jesus, he's thanking God for their love for all the saints. Paul is thankful for their obedience to Jesus' command to love one another. This is a snapshot of an easy way for you to pray for your brothers and sisters. It's easy. Sometimes we complicate prayer. You ever been there before? You know, you say God the Father a lot in that prayer because you don't know what to pray, right? As if you're like, it's almost like you got to tap God a lot. Like, it's just kind of weird. Like I don't talk to Brian Cook and go, Brian Cook, hey, man, you want to go get some food after this? Brian Cook, I just think it'd be cool if we, like, hung out sometime. Brian Cook, maybe we could watch Ahsoka together. Like, see, right? Like, it's annoying, right? Like, you have his attention. We all do it. It's a nervous tick, right? It's almost like you're trying to fill in the gap. But God, you've got God's attention. And here's the thing about prayer. Prayer can be very simple. It can be as simple as what he's thanking God for here. For this church, we always thank God for your faith. We always thank God for your love. And the most important thing is that those two things were evident in the church in Colossae. There was reports coming back to Paul from other disciples saying, this church in Colossae is evidence, they have evidence of faith in Christ, and their evidence is in love for the saints. There's proof of this. And Paul is thankful for these brothers and sisters because of this news of their faith and their love. You see, Paul's attitude of gratitude, this gratitude is essential to Christian disciples. And here's why. It fosters humility. When you and I are thankful for things in our prayers, when you and I are being prayed for and we're having gratitude poured over us, it fosters in us humility. It strengthens relationships. It promotes contentment and deepens one's connection with God. Listen, I can just glaze through a list of things of what gratitude stirs up in us, but I would have you go listen to last November's sermon by me in which I listed a whole bunch of things about gratitude. And I think the Lord had me this week because I'll be honest with you, I stink at gratitude. You can ask my wife. I can get the doldrums or the... dare I say it, the depression, and I forget gratitude. I forget gratitude. It's like the darkness closes in and the only light ahead is gratitude. And the more that I'm more grateful, the more that I speak my gratitude, the more the light shines. This is true for believers. It's all part of our journey as we are growing up into the image of Christ. So if Paul has this attitude of gratitude, and he lays this before the Lord and is thankful for these people. We see the power of his prayer in discipleship, how this kind of will play out, or what he prays for specifically for them. If you look at Colossians 1, 9 through 12, here's the power of prayer on display. And so from the day we heard, this is a callback to him hearing about their faith and their love for the saints. Also from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will and all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. You see, Paul's prayer for the Colossians in this section underscores the idea of the spiritual growth as a profound journey of knowing God's will, of gaining spiritual wisdom, of walking in a manner worthy of the Lord, bearing fruit and enduring with joy. It highlights the importance of relying on God's strength and maintaining an attitude of thanksgiving as believers grow in their faith and their relationship with Christ. I mean, just a couple of weeks ago, Pastor Wade talked about how it's God at work among us, saving those whom he will save. It's his power that saves. It's Jesus' blood that saves. And if it's Jesus' blood that saves, it's also Jesus' blood that causes us to have knowledge, that causes us to have growth, that causes us to be conformed to the image of Christ. Church, discipleship's goal is not for you to be a better human. Discipleship's goal is for you to be conformed to the image of Christ. for you to continue to look like Jesus. Have you ever gone to an art museum, or perhaps you've seen pictures of these large marble statues like David, Michelangelo's David, or the Pienta, or whatever it's called, right? The giant statue of Christ and his mother. Like, have you seen this? It's always fascinating to me, not just as an art person, but it's fascinating to me as a human how they can take, someone took a piece of marble way back in the day and chiseled it to look like a human form, right? So what happened in Michelangelo's mind is that he saw David as he would want it in marble. He probably sketched it out, looked at it, okay, this is what I want. Probably had a model. I don't know. I'm sure he did. But the marble didn't look like that. He had to chunk away pieces of the marble to make it look like what he wanted the image of David to be. This is the same thing that goes on in our life with sanctification. God is constantly chunking away pieces of you that don't look like Jesus. Whatever you might be going through, suffering, whatever challenges you're facing, the goal is for you to be conformed to the image of Christ. The goodness that you're experiencing, the joys that you're experiencing, is all shaping you to have gratitude as you bear the image of Christ. That is the goal of discipleship. We make disciples who make disciples here. Disciples are supposed to look like the one in whom is their master. And that master is not me. It's not Craig. It's not Wade. It is Jesus. It's interesting to me here that Paul says, we have not ceased to pray for you. And he lists the two things that he really wants them to be the actions here, to be filled with the knowledge of his will and all spiritual wisdom. Now, what's interesting about that is Solomon, when the Lord presented to him, he's like, you've built me the temple and you're my dude and I love you. What, you ask anything of me and I will give it to you. And instead of asking for more riches or more wives, in Solomon's case, that would have been a priority probably. But instead, he says, Lord, give me wisdom. And the Lord was easy to grant. Yes, more wisdom for Solomon. And in James, we're told, if we would ask for wisdom, the Father will give us wisdom. Church, we need more wisdom. And this spiritual wisdom that we need is not discerning whether or not we should take this job or this job. The wisdom that we need is not of human origin, but is derived from the Holy Spirit. It encompasses discerning God's ways, applying biblical principles to daily life. It's not following the culture. It's following what Christ has laid out in his word. I used to always say that culture is a funny animal, because we often use the world or the culture and the attitudes of the world as enemies of the church, right? And that's true in some extent. But I will tell you this. The church needs wisdom to discern how to navigate the culture. Not seeing necessarily the culture or the people of the culture, those who are not believers in Christ, as enemies, but how do we navigate in order that we can live a life that is worthy of them saying, hey, what's with you? What is this hope that you have? I find it interesting here that Paul references this knowledge and this spiritual wisdom in light of Proverbs 1:7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Don't be a fool. Be wise. Even King Jesus said to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. This wisdom that he's talking about here is how do we walk in the culture as so to make much of Jesus? Well, Paul then lays that out, doesn't he? He says, if you have this wisdom, this is what's going to happen. So as to walk. That's there because of the last one, right? Like, so as to walk. If you get the wisdom and the spiritual understanding, right, then the goal of that is for you to walk it out, to live a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him. Some of us who have struggled in legalism most of our lives look at this verse and get terrified. And think, well, what does that mean? How do I live a life worthy of the Lord? Do I burn all my AC/DC albums? Do I throw out all my secular music? How do I live in such a way to be walking worthy of the Lord? Brothers and sisters, as simple as this, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. This is how we please the Lord. It's not our clothing. It's not necessarily even what we listen to. Although that could be a problem. I don't know. That's up for your conscience. The issue really is, are you seeking the Lord? Are you desiring him? This pleases the Lord. Are you finding yourself more and more being conformed to the image of Christ so that you want to be closer and closer to the Father? That's Paul's prayer for the Colossian church here. That they would walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, is that they would be walking towards the kingdom of light. You might ask this question, because I asked this question. How? How do I do this? How do I walk in a manner worthy of the Lord? Paul lays it out again for us. Thank God for the scriptures in English, right? I mean, I like all the Greek folks and all those who can read Greek. And man, they're a gift to the church, believe me, because it's all Greek to me, right? How? Bearing fruit in every good work, he says. You bear fruit. You do the things that God has called you to do that bears fruit. Fruit like what? Peaches, apples, pears? What are we talking about here? Be more specific. Well, Paul is thankfully wrote another letter called Galatians in which he gives us all the fruits of the Spirit laid out. Goodness, kindness, gentleness, patience, self-control, love. These are the fruits of the Spirit. You got to ask yourself, am I a fruit-bearing tree? I'll get to that in a second. Increasing in the knowledge of God. This is what he says is how you can walk in a manner. You increase in the knowledge of God. How do you do that? How do you do that? Well, having a relationship with God is what we have. We have a relationship with the Father. In order to increase in the knowledge of someone, you have to get to know them. You have to spend time with them. You have to be around their words and listen to their story. This is an overused illustration, but I'm going to use it anyway because it's so good. If my wife and I, married 23 years now, if we got married, just like Tabitha and Taylor did recently, a couple weeks ago, and we said I do's, and we kissed, we walked down the aisle, and we never talked to each other again, what kind of relationship would we have? Oh, Lord help us. It would be, he said, peaceful. No. For a time. But man is not made to live alone, right? So we need other people around us, not just wives, but we need other people around us. We need to be in relationship with others. But we also, in order to increase in the knowledge of God, need to be in relationship with God. The best two ways to do that, the simplest ways, I'm telling you, it's simple. Prayer and read your Bible. Prayer and, but Brian, I can't read my Bible. I hate reading my Bible. I ain't got time for it. I got 14 kids at home. I can't do it. You got a car, you got an iPod, you got an iPhone, you got something you can listen to the Word of God on. Technology has made it super easy for you to get the Word of God in you these days. Whether that's reading it, listening to it, absorbing it, meditating on it. Look, you don't have to read all of Leviticus in one sitting. Throw up what we've been reading in John and meditate on what Jesus is doing there. That's how you increase in the knowledge of God. Be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might. Man, that's difficult. How do I do that? And that sounds passive. Like, I can't do that. Well, how do you get strengthened in real life? Humans, how do you get strengthened? Work out, practice, eat right, lift heavy weights, right? Is there action involved with that? You're doing something, right? But are you actually, like, doing something with your muscles? Is your muscles doing something? It's circle reasoning here, right? But your actions cause your muscles to strengthen. right? Your muscles aren't really doing anything other than what you're telling it to do. It's the same with your faith here. It's the same with how you can be empowered. It's you taking in God's word. It's you praying. It's you being involved in the spiritual disciplines. It's evangelism. It's journaling. It's all of these ways that you can be strengthened because you're putting yourself in a place to get the power according to his glorious might. What is this glorious might? This glorious might that he's talking about, that Paul is referring to here, over and over in the New Testament, we're told the glorious might of God is the same glorious might that raised Jesus from the dead. So, when you come to Christ, you get this same glorious might. I'm gonna get there in a second. I'm gonna put a pin in that. But he's also saying, you can walk in a manner worthy by being strengthened for all endurance and patience with joy. We all know that growth in the Christian life is not without challenges, without trials. Paul prays that the Colossians would exhibit endurance and patience. And he could have just perioded it. Like, yeah, you're going to go through stuff. It's going to be hard, but you got to endure like a good soldier, period. No, he says, exhibit endurance with patience with joy. That's hard. When we face difficulties and challenges and we do it with joy, that's the mark of a disciple. That's the mark of someone who has been changed by Jesus. And as you go through these things, giving thanks to the Father, which also reflects this heart of gratitude for the work that God has done on our lives. Listen, when I was in middle school, My family decided to buy this plot of land next to our house, and man, it was overgrown. It had like thistles and thorns and weeds tall as a middle school boy, trees, saplings, large trees. I mean, the whole thing was just a wild forest. There was no paths in it. There was none of that stuff. And so one summer, my dad decided that we're gonna clear this land, this lot off, that he had plans for it. Well, he put me to work, right? He allowed me everything a middle school boy should not be allowed to have wielding in said forest. But I was allowed a push mower, a machete, a sickle that summer. I got to use the weed eater. Most importantly, a rake. That's what I used mostly, right? Because I was the middle schooler. I'm not bitter. But however, with these tools, I went to work chopping down what I could. You see, my dad and my uncles, they got better tools. They got like, you know, chainsaws, bulldozers. Yeah, bulldozers. My dad ran the bulldozer, knocked down trees, built, you know, tore up stumps, all this kind of stuff. They also got to use other sharp instruments that I did not get to use. So I'm just a little, move on. But you see, much like these tools that were given to clear this land, this plot of land, all this thicket, if you will, of weeds and whatnot, God provides for us tools. He provides with us the ability, just as Paul's writing about here. In his prayer, he's saying to the Colossian church, you have the ability to access God with thanksgiving, with worship, with adoration. You have access to God the Father through Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit. You and I, as disciples of Jesus, have been gained access to the very throne room of God. How do I know this? Well, there's been a great exchange take place. And this is the gospel's transformative impact on us. Let's read Colossians 1, 13 through 14 together. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us from the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. There's a more clear and concise two verses on the gospel of Jesus than any I know. He has delivered. Who is he? Remember, I had Steve read about he. He is Jesus. He is him, as the kids say these days, right? Jesus. Jesus has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. I heard a guy rail recently about this idea of us calling ourselves sinners. Well, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. And this is true. Yes. We are sinners saved by grace. And man, we are still in this tent of flesh that is prone to wander, as the song says. Our hearts are prone to sin. Our flesh is prone to folly. Yes, I agree. However, how does it change our thinking when we have this attitude of gratitude switched on to where we change our thinking that we're no longer just sinners saved by grace, but we're saints, beloved. We're saints. We're saints being conformed into the image of Christ. This is the power that Christ has given to us. He has transferred us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his beloved Son. This is not illegal immigration, right? This is not us sneaking through the border. This is us being transferred with full rights and privileges of an heir to the throne room. You and I. Every trouble that we come up against, every battle that we face, we have the power of the risen Christ at our disposal. Why? Because we're now saints. We're in the kingdom of God. This kingdom that is characterized by forgiveness, grace, and eternal life in fellowship with the Creator and with one another. Transferred out of the kingdom of darkness that is characterized by sin and death and separation from God. This place, this world, when we hear rumors of wars and we see it on with our eyeballs on our screens, this is not our home. Why do we cling to it, beloved? Yes, Jesus is going to come and he's going to make and prepare a better place for us. Absolutely. Absolutely. But man, what would have happened in your life if your attitude and your mind changed to one of gratitude for the things that you have and the things that you will have one day when Christ returns? This salvation empowers us to live a life worthy of the Lord. This transfer from kingdom of darkness to kingdom of the beloved Son frees us to love one another. It frees us to be discipled and be changed by his grace. Charles Spurgeon once said, "It is not thy hold on Christ that saves thee. It is Christ. It is not thy joy in Christ that saves thee. It is Christ. It is not even thy faith in Christ, though that be the instrument. It is Christ's blood and merit. Are you saved by Christ? Is Christ sufficient for you? Is Christ enough for you? Is Jesus enough for you?" And I'm saying this as I look in the mirror. Is Jesus enough? A pivotal piece of discipleship is taking that Jesus is enough and applying it to others. Spurgeon said, "As soon as a man has found Christ, he begins to find others." Is this a mark of your life? Do you share Jesus with others? And listen, I know it's hard, it's difficult. But when the joy of Jesus bubbles up out of you with a heart of gratitude, man, sometimes I've gone through seasons where I can't not talk about Jesus. And I've gone through seasons where it's been hard to talk about Jesus. But man, when the reality of Jesus' transfer from a state of sin in the kingdom of darkness to the reality of being in his kingdom comes to grip and comes to bear in our life, we begin to walk this road of discipleship. I want to briefly mention this. You and I are in a garden, so to speak. Some of us are seeds that have just heard the gospel, just had it implanted in us, and we need the right conditions to grow. Those right conditions is a metaphor, okay? And that metaphor meaning that the right conditions are faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. You have those conditions, just like you do with a seed, you put it in the dirt goes to work, right? Faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone, goes to work in our hearts. It grows us as if we were in a garden, as if we were trees. Bear with this illustration, right? Seeds produce seedlings. The newly planted seed represents someone who has just accepted Christ and is beginning their discipleship journey. This young plant needs careful attention, nurturing and watering, much like new believers who require guidance, teaching, and supportive Christian community to grow their faith. In our garden at Worthy Redeemer, we have some seedlings here. It's the truth. Some of you think that you're seed-bearing trees when you are more seedlings, but that's a story for another day. There are saplings in our midst. As the plant grows, it becomes stronger, but has yet to mature fully. This stage represents a Christian growing in their faith and understanding of the Bible. They may need mentors and discipleship relationships to support, guide, prune when necessary. And then this sapling turns into a fruit-bearing tree. This is the goal for every Christian, is to become a fruit-bearing tree. Yes, the goal is to become like Christ and be a fruit-bearing tree. Eventually, the plant becomes a mature tree bearing fruit. This tree symbolizes a disciple who has grown in their faith and is actively serving and producing spiritual fruit in the community. These individuals can now take on the role of mentors and disciple others, continuing to growth cycle, continuing to plant. And I would say there's another fourth in the garden. And it's the gardeners. In this garden, there are also experienced gardeners, if you will, who have been tending the tree, these plants for years. They represent mature, seasoned believers who have dedicated their lives to discipling others. They've learned the art of cultivation. They know how to protect against pests and disease, you know, spiritual challenges, if you will. And they are committed to helping every plant reach its full potential. The good news is that Jesus makes the New Testament church. He says, you are both seedlings, seed-bearing trees, but you're also gardeners for each other. Because the Father is the true and better gardener, and he is the one who prunes, he's the one who challenges, he's the one who cuts, he's the one who wards off pests and pestilence. But we are participants, if you will. You and I are able to prune dead leaves off of each other as we get into community together. This garden obviously is a metaphor for the Christian community, right? And sometimes we want to be in a greenhouse and not a garden. Greenhouse is a more controlled environment. That's how we want our Christian life to be. But really, we're in the wild of the garden. And we need each other. To be these fruit-bearing trees, we need our friends, our loved ones, to become gardeners themselves and perpetuate the disciple of discipleship. You need someone in your life who's discipling you, and you need to be discipling someone else. This is Jesus' model. This is Paul's model. It all begins and is all fitted around the gratitude for the progress and faithfulness for those being discipled. It's essential to the process. Otherwise, you'll be frustrated. Otherwise, you'll want to walk away. Like, God, why aren't you growing them faster? God, why aren't you growing me faster? Well, we need to have an attitude of gratitude. The fact that we're growing at all. Man, I can look back on old journals that I have of where I wrote down prayers. I mean, back when I first got married, and I'm like, I'm not that same guy. Tim Keller talks about how his wife was married to like three different dudes. It's just him. Right? But like three different men. And I got to say the same. Like, my wife has been married to like five different men. And that's not a mark on her. She's pure, like, on that whole regard. But like, I've been five different men in my life, like, in just the course of 23 years. Why? Because we're constantly growing, we're constantly changing. So, as I conclude, disciples assemble, right? If you've ever seen Avengers Endgame, maybe this is a spoiler alert, but shame on you, maybe. I don't know, because it's been out for a while. There's a scene where Captain America, everything looks lost. And he hears, on your left, Cap. And all of a sudden, this whole portal start opening up and all the Avengers are standing there against Thanos, right? Captain America's like, guts Thor's hammer, which was like an amazing, like the whole theater's like, ooh, right? You had to experience it. And he finally says the words, Avengers assemble. Well, I'm saying, and I'm not Captain America, but I'm saying to you, disciples, assemble. Let's read verses 11 and 12 again. I'm closing, I really promise. Being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. In light. You, this the key phrase here, you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. This is what gospel community is about. This is what this community is about. This is what church is about. It's you and I sharing in the inheritance of the saints in light. We share in the inheritance of the riches of the blessing of Jesus. And the way that we do that, we can't do that in isolation. We must do that in community. I need the Jesus in you to speak to the Jesus in me and encourage me. Just as you need the Jesus in me to hopefully speak and encourage to you. You see, this sharing of the inheritance is why we would love for you to be in gospel community. We would love for you to be in some form of gospel community where you're being discipled and you're discipling others. You're rubbing shoulders with other Christians in hopes that you are also sharpening each other. The gospel community is not just a fun thing that we came up with. It really is an intentional way to organize how we do the one another's together. How you can cultivate true relationships and friendships. I've been in small groups. I've been in missional communities. I've been in all these things. We can label it whatever you want. When disciples get together and they share their lives together and they share a meal together and they pray for one another and they do that over time and there's safety there, what takes place is a knitting of hearts where all of these things that we want to be as disciples come together as a knot or as a rope that is a lifeline to us. Community is not just a place where we go and check a box. Community should be a place where you go and you are known and you know others. Jesus calls us to lay down our lives for each other. If we aren't in community together, how do we lay down our lives for one another? And laying down our lives could mean laying down our preferences, laying down our favorite time of the week to meet, whatever it might be. It's prioritizing one another. Again, we can't do that in isolation. So here's my encouragement to you. In our gospel communities, in our worship gatherings, if possible, in your times when you go grab coffee with someone, whatever it might be, wherever you get other people together and you talk about Jesus, let this be an encouragement for what you should do. Colossians 3, 12 and 14. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so also you must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. May our communities be marked by gratitude and love. May your discipleship and the discipleship of Worthy Redeemer Church be built a culture of gratitude and love. Love for the Father, love for Jesus, love for one another. May the Spirit do this in our midst. Oh, church, may we be a people marked by these things. So in conclusion, I want to challenge you to read the entire letter of Colossians. We don't normally do like topical stuff here. This is out of the norm for us. I mean, we're in a series of John, but man, Colossians just kind of poked me this week. I wanted to poke you too. So get in Colossians sometime this week. Ask yourself some diagnostic questions like, one, what do you want me to hear, Jesus? Open my heart. Say that prayer, open my heart. So what do you want to hear from me, Jesus, is the first question. The second diagnostic question would be, am I encouraged or discouraged by what I read? Examine me, O God, is our prayer. I don't know. God's trying to cut me off here. All right. Thirdly, in what ways can I obey what is being taught here in Colossians? And ask this prayer, align me with Jesus. I want you to remember that discipleship flows from a culture of gratitude and love this week. We have access to the glory and power of God through prayer, through Christ and his redemption, his life, his death, and his resurrection. And this is empowered for us to bear fruit and walk in a manner worthy of the gospel. Remember this week. I challenge you to engage with a heart full of gratitude and love this week. Just as the Apostle Paul expressed his profound thankfulness for the faith and love of the Colossian believers, let us be grateful for the spiritual growth we witness in one another. I'm grateful for you. I'm grateful for the growth I see in you, the love I see in you, the faithfulness I see in you. So continue to bear each other's burdens and love one another as Christ has loved us. Let's pray. Oh, Father, we love you, Jesus. And Father, we are thankful for your kindness to us, that you don't want us, it's okay for us to not be okay. But you're also not okay with us staying not okay. You want to woo us, you want to beckon us, you want us to crawl up on your lap and be loved by you as our Father. You want to care for us. You want to wrap us in your wings of silver and gold to protect us. And we struggle, Lord. We struggle. We're like children who can't sit still, who don't want that nap that we really need. We're like that child who doesn't think that dad has the best in for us, that he's keeping us from something. God, still our hearts. Cause us to look upon you and be changed by your grace and your mercy. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Every week we kind of rehearse the gospel. Excuse me. We rehearse the gospel in many ways, but one of those ways is we take the Lord's Supper together. So if you have your elements with you this morning, I want to remind you that our table is open to believers. If you've been you've received this transformation from gospel, from the darkness to the beloved Son, to the kingdom of the beloved Son, then you are invited to the table. Baptized believers may come to the table and take in the Lord's Supper with us this morning. So if you're visiting with us and you're a believer, by all means, members, attenders, regular attenders, you know that we like to read from 1 Corinthians. Paul reminds us of what Jesus did. Verse 23 of 1 Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take and eat. Verse 25 says, in the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." We thank you, Jesus, for your death and your resurrection. Let's drink. What we commonly do is we allow our hearts to settle into this first song. We listen, we sit, we contemplate the Lord's Supper, perhaps the message that we heard. Ask yourself this question: do I really believe in Jesus? Have I been transferred from the kingdom of light to the kingdom, or from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light? And then when the second song comes, you may stand and sing along. Let's sing this morning, in Jesus' name.
Myself away. give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me.
Thank you.
The blind won't gain their sight by opening their eyes. And a king is coming into this city, and crowds around are following. If I could see, I would follow too. And he heals the sick with his hands. As he walks by, they reach for him. If I could see, I would reach out to. Sing this out, church, the blind. The blind won't gain their sight. Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David, I want to see. Son of David, have mercy. And I cannot leave this gate, but I cannot see my way. But I can stand and call his name. No, I could never leave this gate, but I will stand and shout his name, and I will count on his grace. The Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of on me, Son of David, I want to see. Son of David, have mercy.
Oh.
Well, it's, as always, it's a treat to sing with you every single Sunday. And as we go, let's just encourage one another with reading the letter from Paul to the church in Philippians, or the church in Philippi, not Philippians, to the Philippians. We're going to read chapter 4, verses 4 through 7, on, if you'll join in with me on verse 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen, church. You are dismissed.